In this video, we want to take a look at some of the algebra properties that limits have. Now, I'll go ahead and give you fair warning. This isn't going to be probably the most exciting video, but we need to understand like how limits work and how you evaluate limits when you have combinations of terms or terms that are added or multiplied or divide. So really, we just need to know the rules that we have to follow when evaluating limits. So just bear with me real quickly here. The limit as x goes to c of the sum or difference of two expressions or two functions says that you can take the limit of the first term plus or minus the limit of the second term. So in short, limits split or break over addition. This is great for like polynomials where you have might have three or four or five terms. There's nothing special you have to do other than take the limit of each individual term and then add those results together. Number two, the limit as x goes to c of some fraction. It says that you can simply take the limit of the numerator and the denominator separately and then divide those answers. So limits work out pretty nice when you have division. Same thing when you have a product. The limit of f times g is the limit of f times the limit of g. So if you get two different answers, you just multiply those two limits together. All right, this is an important one, number four. What do you do when you have the limit as x goes to c of some constant times a function? Or maybe you know the limit of what the function would give, but this constant, we're not really sure what to do with it. One important thing to realize is that constants that are multiples of functions can be pulled outside of a limit because it doesn't depend on this variable x, and so it's allowed to be factored out or pulled outside of the limit. So notice all we have is k times the limit of the function f of x. And the only thing really important to not forget is people get very comfortable with this rule and want to pull things out. If you had something like like an x squared, for instance, you could not pull an x squared out like you would a constant because the limit depends on x. You know, that term would have to stay inside the limit. You can only pull constants outside of a limit. All right, a couple more. The limit of the square root of some function. How do we handle it when we have our x terms inside of a radical? Well, very simply, limits can move inside of a square root, right? So we can take the limit of whatever's on the inside and then take the square root of our answer when we're done. Same thing with any generic power. If you have the limit of something raised to the nth power, the limit can move inside of those parentheses, and we'll take the limit there, and then raise our answer to the nth power. So hopefully those are all pretty clear. Let's try a few super quick examples here. Let's do the first one, limit as x approaches 2. For x squared minus 3x plus 7, we'll evaluate this analytically, which means we'll just try to plug in 2. 2 squared is 4, and 2 times 3 is 6, so 4 minus 6 is negative 2, and negative 2 plus 7 makes 5, right? So you see what we did there? We just distributed the limit and took the limit of all three expressions using that first rule. Calculus, you have to be really careful, and you only do things when you know that you have a rule defined for that, because sometimes our intuition can get us in trouble. All right, limit as x goes to 1 of x squared plus 5 divided by x minus 3. I'm just going to take the limit of each of these respectively and then divide them. So 1 squared plus 5 is 6, 1 minus 3 is negative 2, so 6 divided by negative 2 is negative 3. And lastly, I have one with a radical. This limit can move inside the square root. And so we'd have negative 5 plus 21 is 16, and the square root of 16 is 4. So hopefully that clarifies any questions you may have had as far as like what algebra properties that limits have.